This is in response to three segments on Lawrence O'Donnell's show from Thursday, December 4th, 2014. Hopefully get to all of them. I don't know. I guess the first one was Gross Dereliction of Duty, and another one was Why Do Police Keep Always Only Investigated by Police? Why did the union cops say that was a seatbelt takedown? And the other one was, so there's four segments. Blame the prosecutor if the grand jury doesn't indict. Okay, so let's do this. A gross dereliction of duty. All right. Many conservative commentators, I don't want to name their names, you know, but when Lawrence O'Donnell agrees with Glenn Beck and actually says that he couldn't have said it better himself, in terms of what the fact that there was not an indictment in this case, basically says everything, that we have a wide spectrum on both sides of the aisle because of the video itself that clearly indicates a murder took place, that there wasn't some type of charges that were brought. And we'll get to the part about the prosecutor, but there was not an indictment. And I can't tell you how happy I am to see that there have been so many protests, how peaceful the protests have been, how adamant they are in their willingness and need. It is both black, it is white, it is Hispanic, it has crossed all racial bounds. And I just certainly hope that things can change in the very, very near future. I have a striking feeling that it may not change as much. I'd hope that this is a rallying cry that the police force needs to be better educated, to be better trained, and to have more watchful eyes and to have more oversight over everything. Because we, you know, and of course, there was another case of someone else who got killed today in Arizona. Of course, we don't know the case about that one. We had the little kid in Cleveland. So, I don't want to hear a lot of this because that's what's going to happen. Every single day, if someone gets shot by a police officer in this country, there's going to be headlines on it, and some of it will obviously be justified, and then others may not. So, I hope that it just isn't. I hope that we can start the process of getting good practices back into place. Now, the next thing Lawrence talked about is why do police always investigate the police and the DA's involved? All right, but here's the thing. Cop kills someone, they're put on administrative leave, they do it, the cop gives his thing, he talks to his lawyer, the private lawyer's with the union lawyer. It's funny, that Republicans hate all unions, but they love the police. And so I guess that means that they love the police union. And I don't know if the police union was behind anything bad in all of this, but I do know that they will do anything to protect one of their own. Anything to protect one of their own. And why is it that, we've always had a system of government and the judiciary, going back to England in 13th, 14th century, somewhere around there, where we had neutral arbitrators, that would look at things and make a decision. In some cases, they knew the people, and then as time went on, they did not know the people. But the idea is that they would be neutral. That would mean that they could be objective. That would mean that they would make a decision based on what they felt was either right or wrong, good or bad, that type of thing. In the case of the police investigating the police, they have an inherent interest to protect that person who may have done wrong, and not to punish that person who may have been wrong, because it would put a blight or a stigma on the police force that they had a bad apple. So to protect a couple bad apples, it makes everyone look bad. So I think that it should be the reverse. You get rid of all the bad apples, then everyone is good. As Lawrence pointed out, many officers go through their entire careers, 20, 30 years, never firing a single gun, never having to go up before an administrative board, having to go up before some judicial board in terms of any type of suits being brought against them. And we also know that New York City has millions of dollars that they pay out every year for police brutality and things like that. But again, an officer, investigating the police, I think is the wrong way to go. We need an independent judicial board, something in there. I do realize they have internal investigations and internal investigations. They're still hit up pretty hard, but I think that they should be 100% neutral and 100% objective and not part of the police force at all. I'd like to see that there were a lot more women that got involved and as were part of that, because this is a men's game. This is a men's game. This is a white men's game, protecting the white men. All right? And of course, they do have brothers that are on the force. And I don't mean to be that disrespectfully, but you know, when you're on the police force and you're a cop, they protect everybody. But most of it's white people, especially in a lot of these bigger cities. Now, I probably said that wrong. Oh, well. Now, the next thing was Lawrence had the guy up there, guy that got lynched or whatever his name was, who is the union rep or the union president of the union of the New York City police force. Now, let me just go over this one thing real quick, and let's get it out. Just get it out of the way. The mayor de Blasio wants the representatives of the city of New York, who are there to protect the people, to be well educated, well armed, and well disciplined in terms of how to work with the public and how to effect a proper arrest, etc., etc., etc. And to make sure that deference is given when deference is needed to people of color, because we don't, because that is what's needed. All right. And he was not taking down the police force. He was not throwing them under the bus. He was indicating, hey, things have got to change. When we have something that goes on that is this egregious, we have to look at this. We have to assimilate this. We have to go start from scratch. Look at every single thing. Look at how we can improve. How can we improve? Step by step by step by step, and make those improvements and bring them in, bring those good practices in, and allow that to happen. Not to have the police force with the union representative, the president of the union, say, you threw us under the bus and we're going to go, you know, we're not going to do our job or anything like, or whatever it is that they might, may or may not do. No, de Blasio was saying, we need to take a look at this. We need to look at this hard. If there are some bad apples in there, we need to get rid of them. Union representatives be damned, we need to get rid of the people who are bad or not, who should never have been on the police force. And, and I don't mean to laugh, but then he talked about how he had a very perfect seatbelt takedown where he went underneath the shoulder and he grabbed the guy and he took him down. Okay, yes, right at the initial stage, he did go underneath the arm. But before the guy had even gotten down, before Gardner was even on the ground, he had taken that one arm back and he had put the other arm completely around the guy's neck. So when Gardner was lying on the ground, that guy's right arm or left, I think it was his right arm, was completely free. He had his left arm completely around Gardner in a chokehold, and he did not have his arm underneath for that seatbelt thing. So the seatbelt was part of the takedown, but everything else was a complete chokehold. And I understand, you know, when you get excited in the heat of the moment, and these guys are adrenaline junkies, they do that. And of course, this guy who had the chokehold has been cited for a couple other things. The New York City has paid out a couple thousand bucks to some people. He's done some, not too bad of stuff. But, you know, and Billy said that he would take his arm off, he would have loosened his hold. You know, Billy, you were just like them, you never would have done that. But for the cop, for the chief of the president of the union to basically sit there and say, oh my God, he did a perfect takedown, he did the seatbelt hold. No. He started with that, then he went to a chokehold, he held the chokehold, the guy was completely immobilized, he had his right arm completely out and his hand open like this as he was lying down. Okay, and you still were choking him, because I watched it, we timed it. Yeah, long time that thing went on. And so, again, things have to change. That was outlawed 20 years ago. And so you can say, oh, I didn't mean to do it. This wasn't the intent. We didn't want to do this. This was just a simple takedown of a guy. We had no intention of hurting this guy. It's a sad thing that happened. I'm really sorry, and I pray for him every day. Fuck you. You know, you did something wrong. It was against policy for 20 years, and I hope that the police commissioner takes it, gets rid of your ass real quick. And anyone else who's been indicted for that in the last 2 years, I think should be gone right away also. Now let's get back to the last part that Lawrence went into, and that would be the fact. Do not blame the grand jury for any of this stuff. Blame the prosecutors. Now, of course, Lawrence has gone over in great detail about the lady in Ferguson, but we don't know anything about the grand jury in Staten Island or wherever this grand jury took place. All we know is that there are 23 people on the grand jury, and that only 12 of them basically have to say we don't want to indict for that thing to go away. And the question is, of course, we don't have any information in terms of what the grand jury was presented. Lawrence goes into, again, very clarifying, that, hey, guess what? You know, if as has been said before, if a prosecutor wants to indict a ham sandwich, they can indict a ham sandwich. The prosecutors have been on Lawrence's show, many other shows, on CNN and MSNBC, can say that basically, if a prosecutor, if they want an indictment, they can get an indictment in a half hour, they can get an indictment in a day, because all they have to do is present the relevant evidence that would say that there is more than a reasonable amount of doubt about what happened here, and that this person needs to go to trial so that we can prove equivocally whether or not a crime had actually been committed or not. So then that gets back to the police being part of the police, and the DA being an integral part of what the police work is, having to work with the police, to have to cut deals all the time, blah, blah, you know, to have something that's completely separate from all of this, to look at this in a completely objective way. And that's what we need, you know. And again, I want to go back to, you know, Bill O'Reilly, all these other people who are talking about how great the police force is. They don't really kill that many blacks because they arrest 100,000 blacks a year, you know, and only a couple hundred killings. Blah blah, etc. You know, again, I go back to how many deaths in the UK last year? How many deaths in Germany last year by the police? How many deaths in France? How many? You know, what was it? 20 between those three countries last year, and we had how many hundreds? You know, why? Why? Of course, we're being, you know, obviously officers don't know when people are not armed. But again, anytime that they shoot someone, they say, "Oh, I thought he was armed. He was going for his waistband." All that kind of happy horse crap. Okay, so we need to make changes. We need to make changes sooner rather than later.